अस्सलाम वालेकुम दोस्तों, सतकरतार वाहिगुरु जी का खालसा वाहिगुरु जी फतेह। नमस्कार, ए वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग कैलिफोर्निया एंड ए वेरी गुड इवनिंग इंडिया। वेलकम टू द 136th मेला ऑफ द ऑन गोइंग यारनाथ वर्चुअल बैडक सीरीज विच इज डेडिकेटेड टू द 550th बर्थ एनिवर्सरी ऑफ गुरु नानक देव। एंड आई एम इन कन्वर्सेशन विद हिंदुस्तानी वाद्य संगीत्स, you know, one of the finest violinists, Vidushi Kala Ramnath. She's joining me today from Redwood City, California. A couple of words about her. Vidushi Kala Ramnath is a California-based, as I mentioned, exponent of Hindustani classical violin. She is niece of Professor T.N. Krishnan and of Dr. N. Rajam. Kala came under the tutelage of her grandfather, Vidwan A. Narayan Iyer. A leading disciple of Pandit Jasraj, Ramnath is acclaimed as playing singing violin for her technical contributions to instrumentally rendering Hindustani vocal music. And I hope to touch base with her about the contributions and the innovations that she has made in the playing of the instrument. She has performed at India's top stages and across the world at venues including Sydney Opera House, Teatro de la Ville, Queen Elizabeth Hall, San Francisco's Palace of Fine Arts, Singapore's Esplanade, Carnegie Hall, and the Edinburgh Music Festival. Ramnath has worked with institutions including the London Symphony and London Philharmonic Orchestra, and with iconic innovators including Ustad Zakir Hussain, George Brooks, Bella Fleck, and Edgar Meyer. She's co-founder of the world music bands Rag Africa, Global Conversation, and Yashila. Her violin is featured in the Grammy-nominated Miles from India project, and pieces of her composition won Grammys and Hilary Hahn's in 27 pieces and the Kronos' Quartet's 50 for the Future. Songlines magazine recognized Ramnath as the world's top 50, among the world's 50 best instrumentalists, and selected her album Kala as one of the 50 best recordings. Ramnath lent a violin to the soundtrack for the Oscar-nominated Blood Diamond. She is a top-grade artist of the All India Radio and Doordarshan, and a recipient of Sangeet Nat Academy Puraskar. Founder of the Kala Shri, her institution aims to enrich the lives of sick and underprivileged children through music. दोस्तों जी आया नू 136वां यारनाथ वर्चुअल बैठक सीरीज का मेला हैगा। इंस्पायर्ड तुहानू पता है बाबा शेख फरीद की तुक तो कि दूधा थनी ना आवई फिर होए ना मेला। ये मेले आप कर रहे हैं इस तो पहला कि आप विछड़ जाइए, दूधो थन जुदा हो जाए। अज मेरी वार्ता होएगी विद्वान वायलन वादक विदुषी कला रामनाथ के नाल, जो कि मेरे नाल रेडवुड सिटी कैलिफोर्निया अमरीका तो जुड़ रहे हैं। आप उत्थे ही रहते ने वसनीक कैलिफोर्निया दे हनगे, ते ये पतीजे पतीजी वांगो हनगे वड्डे प्रोफेसर टी एन कृष्णन जड़े विद्वान हुए ने, और डॉक्टर एन राजम जड़े वड्डे वायलन वादक हनगे दुनिया दे। इन्हां दी जड़ी सिख्या है अपने दादा होना दे चरना छुई विद्वान ए नारायण अय्यर होना दे कोल, यानी कि पंडित जसराज दे मोरी शिष्या चो हनगे। इना दा क्या जांदा है कि जिवें कि गाउंदी वायलन वजाउंदे हनगे, या इना दी वायलन गाउंदी है जदों वजाउंदे हनगे, सिर्फ वजदी ही नहीं है वो गाउंदी है। और खास करके जड़ियां हिंदुस्तानी संगीत दियां जड़ियां गायन दियाँ रीतां हनगियाँ बंदिशां हनगियाँ, उस उन्होंने इन्होंने वायलन ते बहुत ही उंधा तरीके नाल बाकाबलीयत दिखाई है, उन्होंने बाकमाल जिन्हों कही उन्होंने उन्होंने तर्जमा किया। दुनिया के वड्डे स्टेजिस ते, हिंदुस्तान दी वड्डी स्टेजिस ते इन्होंने गाया, जिदे विच मैं नाल लैते ने सिडनी ओपरा हाउस वर्गे, कार्नेगी हॉल, क्वीन एलिजाबैथ हॉल। दुनिया के मैं अंग्रेजी में कह चुका, मैं दोहराने की लोड़ नहीं। इन्होंने काम भी किया बड़े इंस्टीट्यूशंस के नाल, जिन्हें लंदन सिम्फनी और लंदन फिलहारमोनिक ऑर्केस्ट्रा वर्गे वड्डे संस्थान, और दुनिया के वड्डे जिहड़े इनोवेटर्स कहते हैं या जिहड़े बहुत ही बाहोश और रोशन दिमाग हनगे जिन्हां चों उस्ताद जाकिर हुसैन दा नाम लेंदे हनगे, जॉर्ज ब्रुक्स दा, बेला फ्लैक और एडगर मेयर दा। इन्हां ने म्यूजिक बैंड बनाए ने, को फाउंडर हनगे तीन, जिन्हां चों राग अफ्रीका ग्लोबल कन्वर्सेशन ते यशिला करके हैगा। इन्हां दी जिहड़ी वायलिन हैगी आ उह ग्रैमी नॉमीनेटिड जिहड़ियां कुछ एल्बम्स हनगियां माइल्स फ्रॉम इंडिया प्रोजेक्ट करके, उहदे विच वी जिहनूं कहीए इन्हां ने नामना खट्टिया। और खास करके कुछ इन्हां दा जिहड़े पीसिस सीगे कंपोजिशन दे विच जिहनूं ग्रैमी मिलिया, वो हिलरी हान दा इन 27 पीसिस ते क्रोनोस क्वार्टर्स दा 50 फॉर द फ्यूचर जिहड़ी एल्बम सी, उन्होंने इनाम भी मिले। सोंगलाइन मैगजीन ने रामनाथ उन्होंने दुनिया के 50 उगमे जड़े वादक हैं कि उन्होंने गिरे इन्हों की एल्बम कला दुनिया दिया 50 बेहतरीन रिकॉर्डिंग्स चों गिणिया उन्होंने। आपने ऑस्कर नॉमीनेटेड जी फिल्म है ब्लड डायमंड भी वायलिन वजाया। आप टॉप आर्टिस्ट हैं कि ऑल इंडिया रेडियो दूरदर्शन के और संगीत नाटक अकादमी पुरस्कार वीएना के चरणों च अर्पण होया होया। इन्होंने कलाश्री फाउंड की थी जो इन्होंने संस्था है जो कि बीमार ते जड़े गरीब बच्चे हनगे उन्होंने संगीत राही ये उन्होंने सेवा करते हैं, उन्होंने जीवन बेहतर करन कारणशील हनगे। सो वेलकम टू द 136 वर्चुअल बैठक कला। So wonderful to see you.
Thank you.
And how is the mahal? I see that California has been burning, and of course the COVID-19 crisis is there, and you're sort of trapped with your mom and brother and everybody.
So basically, what I just wanted to tell you that I live in Mumbai. And I have part of my family here. So usually during summer, I come here when it's very hot in India. And then I go back after the monsoons. So, but this time due to the pandemic, my whole family is here. My brother is here, my mom is here, my niece is here, my brother's wife, all of us are together here.
But you're always chasing your mom, or your mom is chasing you? You're always sort of together, isn't it? You stay with her. That's so wonderful. But I'm so glad you're together. At least, you know, I was in conversation with Ushi Aruna Sairam 2-3 months back, and fortunately she was also stuck in Seattle but with her children, so that was good. I was at that time stranded in Rome alone. Yeah. All alone. Maurizio was here in Delhi, elder son in Bologna, younger one in Turin. We were like 4 people in 4 cities. So I'm sort of jealous of everyone who's with the family, because I've been stranded alone. And I know that you have a doctor's appointment. You have an appointment at 11-ish. We have, this will be our first part of the conversation, so that I, everybody who's joined us are informed at the very onset. And but there is a lot, you know, that I have, of course, there are two, these conversations, Kala, are not what all is happening. It's not, I always tell, if you want to listen to the music, buy the CDs and albums of the artists. These conversations, which I began, and this series of conversations has sort of inspired so many conversations around the world, because I was in Europe when I started in March, April. And this is like one of the core, you know, sort of formats that was liked by many people. But my purpose here is the, it's to sensitize people what it is to be a Vidwan. How is it to become a Vidwan? How many Vidwans invest their energy and their vision in sculpting a Vidwan and offering it to the coming decades or years, that those who will outlive themselves, you know? That is the process. And of course, illustrations come as but when we are looking at rag forms or compositional structures or ornamentations or compositional structures, etc., etc., different composers, That's where, of course, illustrations come. Alap systems, Bhailava systems, how a certain tradition or a Vidwan touched a note, tasted a note, and uttered a word, if at all. So that's the sort of the intent behind these betaks. And that's why they are longish, because it takes time. Sometimes the life journey is very moving and very intimate, and how the journey, and yours is, I know, we've spoken over several years, bits here, bits there, but I have a good memory of how you sort of began and how you, you know, had the fortune of studying with Pandit Jasraj as well. Tell me about your grandpa first. I mean, you began at his feet. How is it? What memories do you have?
So basically, I hail from a musical family of, I'm the seventh generation.
How fantastic.
My sisters were all court musicians in the court of Travancore, Kerala. So we are originally from Kerala.
Amazing.
So, in my house, I have my uncle and my aunt, all of them, you know, play the violin. So basically, it was my grandfather who took up violin. So before that it was all vocal music. My great-grandfather was the last, court musician. At this court of Travancore. Mm-hmm. And then after that, you know, I think independence, and after that, I don't think they had any court musicians in Travancore.
1950, they all disbanded anyway.
My grandfather was in Mumbai, working in the accountant general's office.
I see.
And he lived in near Kemp's Corner, and he met, he used to meet Vishnu Digambar Paluskar and Bhatkandeji and all those, Devdharji and all those people. They would have musical conversations, and my grandfather would accompany them on the violin during these conversations.
I see.
So he developed a ear for Hindustani music, though he had learned only Carnatic
music. Yeah, I was about to come to that, yeah.
And then he also used to play in films.
Also, so, in Bombay.
That's why were all the first films he's played the violin there.
I see. That's amazing.
Yeah.
But he himself was, but your grandpa was trained by his father already?
Yes, was trained by his father, but I do not have an idea how he took up the violin. I think it is self-taught. क्योंकि नहीं तो मुझे पता चलता कि उन्होंने कहे किससे सीखा है वगैरह वगैरह. मुझे लगता है it was self-taught. And my grandfather was a great visionary. Musically, he was like, I would call him like one sage.
I see.
Number of students he taught. He did not take it up as a career. He was a very good violinist, but he was a very good teacher too.
I see.
So he was a great guru. So I can say that because I remember when I was 4 or 5 years, he started me on the violin at the age of 2.
Wow.
During Sharad Navratra.
I see.
2 years or 2.5 years of age. Mm. And I remember when I was 4, 5, 6 years old, even 7, he would wake me up suddenly in the middle of the night. Mm. He was very affectionate, but at the same time, he would be thinking how to teach me. Mm. So wake up suddenly at 2:30 and 3 and wake me up and say, come play, I have to teach you something. So my grandmother would fight with my grandfather And they're like, Chiha, what the hell are you doing to the skin? Let her skin. And they would, and he would turn around and tell her, you mind your business. I know what I'm doing.
That's amazing.
So they would have constant fights over me. My grandmother supporting me and my grandfather saying, you mind your business. But my grandfather, even if he made me play at 2 or 3, then he would put me back to sleep, then tell me stories, draw me off at school and pick me up, and on the way back buy me candies. And then, and if I practiced something for a long, whatever he said, if I did, he'd carry me to get me, there was a restaurant where you got very good kheer.
Oh.
So he would be there and then buy me kheer and then bring me back. He was very affectionate also.
So do you remember some things from him, what he was teaching you?
Oh yeah, I mean, the technique that I have today is totally because of my grandfather.
Oh really? Share with us something from him. Did he compose himself, or he played traditional compositions?
Basically, he's never taught me with sitting with the violin.
I see.
I would play that on the violin. He would tell me, use this finger.
I see.
So that is how I've learned completely, which is why for me, hearing something and reproducing it back is very, very easy for me.
I see.
And exactly as it's sung. Like, for example, if you have a phrase like, if I have to play this, one bow. That will all be in one bow. Like exactly as you sing. Wherever you take a breath, that's where I switch bows. Otherwise, the complete phrase, I don't break it in the middle.
Yeah.
So the usage of my bow.
Fantastic. And that's your memory from your grandpa. I mean, he would sing and you would render it. Uska nikas.
Yes.
Thank you. But then the idea of the music that he would have sung to you, was it the traditional Karnatak, what is called Karnatak Sangeet, or what?
Since when he was in Bombay, baqaida wo Hindustani seekh rahe the.
I see.
Or when Bua went to Pandit Omkarnath Thakur,
yes,
he was with her all the time. So
oh my goodness, acha.
Yeah, so he was absorbing everything. So he would sit with me and play ektal for me for riyaz.
Achha. But then, so in your ears with him, I mean, this anything from your great-grandfather that came down, or was it the Hindustani music that he was now getting accustomed to?
I also have a diary which he had maintained. It's in my Bombay house. Mm-hmm. But I do have pictures on my phone. I've taken pictures of it.
Uh-huh.
Where he has written the month and the year I started music. And first year what I was playing, second year, every day he had maintained a record of what I played. And by 74, I was playing around 30 rags.
I see.
1970, from 69 to 74.
Hmm.
By 74 is when he stopped maintaining that for me.
I see. It became too much.
Otherwise, like, it would be like all the rags that he taught me.
Hmm.
And then there, every day I was supposed to expound on a particular rag, on one rag. After that, I had to play all the other compositions for it to remain in me, inside me. And today also, because of that kind of training, I don't need to write any composition. I remember everything.
Mm.
So he maintained this diary where he also mentioned she fell sick. She was in the hospital for so many days. She had measles. She had chicken pox. All this mentioned there. So no practice. And then what all I practiced, how many days I played sometimes weekends I have played morning and evening, you know, vistar of a rag I've done. So all that is mentioned. There is a dot there. She did this. So
so the first learning was from him, yes. And the music that was coming to you was from his association by way of your aunt studying with Pandit Omkarnath Thakur. So that was Pandit Omkarnath Thakur's singing was already coming onto your fingertips.
Yeah.
Is that right?
And also used to play, so that I would hear my aunt. I remember when I was 4 or 5 years old, since my grandfathers and grandmother, they stayed with my dad, the whole family would meet during summer holidays. All of them would land up at my place. And then all the cousins would be asked to play, you know, the violin.
Achha.
And each one of their children and all that. So, yeah. But my grandfather would never talk about me. And I would ask him, why don't you ask me to play? So he would say, you need to play so well that they should ask you. I shouldn't ask you to play.
That is fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actually going to surprise you with something.
Uh-huh.
Something.
Looks like you have a violin.
Oh, come on, you broke the secret. I was.
I saw the symbol of the violin.
Yes. So this is a violin made by me.
Really?
Yeah. this is a this is a copy of a Stradivari. How this is the first time I'm showing it publicly. I made it for, I guess, the I think the greatest violinist that I've heard was the legendary Baba Thakur Singh, who lived in anonymity for 48 years. And Prithviraj Kapoor used to do dandaut to him when he was 14-year-old prodigy in 1950 or 1949. Sarojini Naidu would have him in his in her lap. And then he was 23, 4 or 5 when he went anonymous. And he then stopped playing everything at age 36. So
wow.
This I made is a 100-year-old spruce. I made it in Utah, in Spring City, in Utah, under the guidance of my friend Paul Hart. So this is a 100-year-old spruce, and it's iska jo pole head, it fell down because there was it was just small technical error. I mean, it's just that I was changing this piece. It fell off. I did not have the braces to keep it intact. But this was
to tie the
I know,
violin with the
I know, yeah. It was just that it slipped. Somehow it was slipped, you know, slipped off. But this is a, and it's been varnished as old varnish. You know, it's antiqued. It's not. It's been aged as such. Yeah, it's and it's
looks
signed.
Very, I'm sure it'll sound nice too.
Oh, it was when it was tested by Philip. Who was the first soloist of the Paris Philharmonic Orchestra in 2001, just the winter after 9/11 attack. I was in Spring City. And this is a bow by Charles Bazon, from which is, of course, as you know, this would be very tens of thousands of dollars worth. So this was matched thanks to Alain Heroux, the bow maker, who knew the story that I was making the violin for him with Paul Hart, because this ascetic who lived in anonymity would not take money from a householder. So I made the violin in order to get him to play. So, bow was gifted, donated by...
I would just suggest one thing.
Yeah.
Just lose it up.
Yeah, yeah, I do. I know. I just did it for you to see, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
I play the taus, no? I play the string instruments. I'm the one who handcrafted instruments back to, yeah. So this is, I thought you'll be surprised to share with you my... You. Maybe when you are in Delhi next, we will have you try this violin as well. So it was played by, I went from the United States when I, once it was done, I made it in 9 days, the body with Paul Hart. We did two violins. He was one step ahead of me. I would be following what we were doing. It was sort of a record. And he was shocked that I have 9 days. I was working about 20, 21, 2 hours a day. And he thought, oh, you work like a mad maniac, you know, like even the Batik series, people have seen me always up. So... and then he put the joints together and I took it to Paris to have it assessed by Raffin, who was one of the top bow makers. His daughter used to assess to actually see if the instrument was good enough to offer at the feet of Baba Thakur Singh. So Thakurji used to be very close to Lata Mangeshkarji's father. It was very, very old that he went anonymous. Anyway, that's my little association. I don't play the violin, but I have made a violin. So that's my luthiery part of it. So tell me something about that. How long was your association with the music of Pandit Omkarnath Thakur? And when were you and how were you introduced to Pandit Jasraj?
So, I gave my first public performance at the age of 12. And my aunt, Rajanji, was responsible for having me perform. And so, she decided to present me as a duo with her daughter, Sangeeta.
I see.
So, we were on our way to Bombay after a concert in Bangalore, and so she was performing at at some place where Panditji, Jasrajji had asked her to perform. So he was arranging this whole thing for somebody else. So we were in the train in from Bangalore to Bombay, and in the same train, Kishori Amankarji was also there. And our train was put in Vidya Vihar yard because of some unrest there with local trains and these long distance trains getting preference during peak hours. So if the long distance train is late, they put it in the yard and wait for the hours to get over before they let the long distance trains move. So we were there, and suddenly we saw a man walking, wearing a dhoti and walking. And those days, no cell phone, nothing. He had gone to the other station, figured out the train was somewhere in Ghatkopar. He came to Ghatkopar. They told him it's in Vidya Vihar yard. And so he's crossing all these train tracks in his dhoti and kurta. And I look up and I asked my cousin, isn't that Pandit Jasraj? I had not seen him. I'd only seen him on records and listening to his. That's all I knew about him, right? And then she said, oh my God, yes, it's him. And then we told my aunt, and then we waved and he came and he said, get down right now. And then we said, how did you find out we were here? He was planning to come and look from every
carriage.
train ki jo dibba hai, he was planning to look. And he took us. And he was such a nice person, so affectionate. I was just a young kid, right? Like, I was just being pampered by him, and I really enjoyed, you know, whatever I wanted was done, was given to me.
I see.
So my association with him started, and I always loved his music, because when I heard him at the age of 7, which is when I remember hearing music, I thought his music is so beautiful, this is what I want to do in life. So that inspiration to do take up music as a career, I think, goes to him, because I loved his music. And also, of course, I was very much influenced by my aunt, in the sense, when I played the violin, I wanted to look like her. I wanted to play like her. You understand? So that was also there in the side. But the way music sounded to me when he sang, I felt that is the kind of music. If this is how beautiful it is, this is what I want.
I see.
So musically, you know, where this inspiration came from.
And how old were you at the time of the train incident, if I may call it one? Or train spotting?
And what?
How old were you when you spotted him from the train?
Well.
At the time when you were mentioning, at the time when you were performing at age 12. I see.
That is when, after we went there, and we were in a hotel and all, and he heard me accompany my aunt.
I see.
And he said, well, let's have her play a concert. I will arrange me. So my aunt, I don't know how good she's going to be, and this and that. So he said, let's make both the girls play.
I see.
So let's have a, you know, what do you say, check. You know, a rehearsal kind of thing for these.
You remember
kids.
What you played?
Huh?
Do you remember what you played then together with Sangeeta?
Yes.
Why don't you share with us?
I was asked to play. We practiced two rags. One was Yaman and one was Bageshri. And I think we played a Khamaj Banarasi folk composition, Dadra or something.
Why don't you share with us? The compositions you played there.
The composition I played, I remember.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, one second.
That's quite a story. Fantastic story.
Yeah. I'm using the electronic fan.
Yeah,
cooler.
yeah, of course, of course. बिन
नहीं
ये कौन सी है? अच्छा दैट वन, हाँ ठीक है. वेरी सिमिलर टू ए री री. हाँ very similar structure.
See,
similar in structure. So, fantastic. And the Bageshri one? Yes, go ahead. You were saying something.
Oh, according to the words in the composition. So I bow according to the words.
Yeah. You're singing, your violin is, you're actually singing through the violin. Yeah.
That's exactly how I play.
And what was the Bageshwari one that you played in the concert?
Bageshwari.
Yaad aa raha hai? Are you able to recall?
Definitely yaad hai.
Acha.
Ek minute, main Bageshwari ka dekh rahi hu.
Oh, That's fantastic. Well, thank you for that. That's amazing. Do you remember the first reactions of Pandit Jasraj and your aunt after the concert?
Oh, before the concert is what the reaction
Achha.
Is what you
before the concert, okay.
I was 12 years old, and the reality or the seriousness of playing a concert, my mind was playful, right? So I would practice and I would keep forgetting and make mistakes, and that would enrage my aunt so badly because she was so nervous of putting me on stage, and she had agreed to this with Panditji. And here I was like, I have to play tomorrow and I'm still making mistakes. And Panditji would come and sit, Guruji would come and sit, and he would look at me and he would know I was going to make a mistake, and he, you know, ishara to me that you're going to make a mistake here. But trust me, I would do the same mistake over and over again, get yelled at, and then he would feel sorry for me. So after practice, he would take me out. He would talk to me, he would tell me, you know, you should not do these things, you should be more, you know, aware on stage, you cannot do this. And he would buy me a chocolate, if nothing was available, at least a banana.
I see.
To make me feel good, that everything was good. But of course, on that day, I played very well. I still have a recording of it.
Oh, you have it, really? Fantastic. And so, that was the beginning of the, I mean, the first meeting at age 12. And
yes.
Then how was the introduction made and your interest? What age did you begin to study from him?
So after that, of course, things changed in my life. I lost my dad 6 months after all this.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. And my grandfather was already, you know, he had really aged by that time. He was like, I would say, he was 85, 86 years old when my dad passed.
That would have hit him.
Or maybe over 80, I don't know what it was. So he was, yeah, he should be 85, 86 at that time. Yeah, my grandfather was old. And then my, so for me, life changed.
Yeah, because losing his own son would have aged him much, you know, faster than he would have otherwise been.
My grandmother also, like both of them were totally shattered when my dad died. And life wasn't easy after that. You know, with the no earning member in the family and all that. So, Guruji, Panditji was the first one who, I still remember his telegram coming. Those days, telegrams would come expressing his condolences. And then 2 months later, when he came to Chennai, where I was living at that time, he decided to speak to, you know, people to have little concerts of mine in, you know, so he spoke to Appa Jalgaonkar to have my concert in Pune, and Appaji did my concert, and after hearing me play there, I got called in Aurangabad, Nanded, Bid, and from there I went to Ambejogai, I went to Latur, you know, by word of mouth. So I started
Ambejogai and others, Pandit Shankarasha Debu Ahwe Gaonkar used to be there.
Yeah.
Shindebua, Pahavaj.
Yes. So I just got, so he started it off for me by speaking, and then I started performing, and I'd earn 200, 300,
I see.
You know, things. Yeah, every concert I'd make 400, 500, something like that. Travel in second class, and my mom would go with me and come back. I was, I mean, then Ustad Zakir Hussain also had come at that time to see me and my mom and everything. He had come home. So Zakir Bhai said, he listened to me and he said, "You're playing like your aunt. Who would want to listen to an imitation?"
I see.
So that stuck in my head. And he said, "You're welcome to come home, stay in Bombay, and figure out what you want, how you want to figure this thing out that I told you. You have to be an original if you want to be in this field, if you want to last long."
Mm.
And whatever it is, blood is thicker than water. So your aunt's daughter will definitely be more accepted than you copying your aunt.
Fair enough.
I mean, it made sense to me when I was, you know, when I started thinking at 14 and 15, when I grew up, I said, "Oh, what he says makes total sense." Then I started thinking, and the only person I knew and whose music I loved was Pandit Jasraj. I like Kishori Ji's music also very much, and I met her when I was 12 also. But the affection that Pandit Ji gave me, I think, clinched it.
Stole you away from the Kishori Amonkar possibility.
Yeah, and I used to listen to her also a lot.
Mm.
So when I used to sing one day, Guruji said, "Khabardar Kishori ke paas gayi to."
Acha.
Very good music. She said, "Khabardar uske paas gayi to." Yeah.
did you tell Kishori Ji this story?
No, I haven't. No, I didn't.
Well, now she knows.
Yeah. He said that to me, hearing my music, because there's so much of, you know, when you keep listening, there's a lot of influence, right? It slowly creeps up. You don't know from where. And he gauged that from my singing, and he said, "Khabardar udhar gayi to."
I see. So which year then you decided, my question, which year then you actually, you know, realized that that's where you want to learn? So your concerts have begun, you've begun to travel, you're getting your 400-500 bucks in pocket, you got some pocket money, you're sort of independent, a pro on the circuit, and
so
then...
17, when I was 17, 18 years old, mentally I decided I'm going to Jasraji. And then when I was 19, after I'd finished my graduation, I finished graduation by 18 years of age.
I see.
Yeah, so when I finished my graduation, I asked him, "Will you teach me?" So he looked at me and he said, I said, "Yes, I want to learn. I want to get better at what I'm doing." So then he said, "I will definitely teach you. Why will I not teach you?" And he said, "Join me in Kolhapur." And that's how my education started, because I was playing with him on stage immediately.
I see.
He said, "Come on stage with your violin in Kolhapur. I'm taking you. You're performing with me. You're going to accompany me."
I see.
But I said, "Don't I need to..." He said, "I know you've learned a lot of my compositions," because there was a... even when I was 12, he sang a... what is it? A tappa, "O Mia Jane Wale."
Ah, yes.
So, you know, when he sang it, and I immediately played that on the violin.
Kaise jata hai tappa tumse Punjabi sune jara?
Okay.
Pehle uska text padh ke sunao Punjabi mein.
Main shayad galat bolungi.
Arre, doesn't matter, main theek kar dunga, koi nahi. इस बहाने कुड़ी तो पंजाबी सुनांगे।
बजा के सुना देती।
You see, my brother-in-law is a Kerala cadre IAS, right? Senior bureaucrat, Inderjeet Singh, IAS. My big sister's husband, and he speaks very good Malayali. You know, very good. You wouldn't, from the phone, you wouldn't know that it's a Sardar speaking Malayali. So, you owe us a few words of Punjabi back.
1 minute, let me slow this down.
Yeah, it's a bit much, yeah. talking of Badi, Pallavi saying hi to you. पढ़ के सुना दो ना, गा के भी सुना दो, गाती भी तो बहुत अच्छा हो, खून में तो गाना भी है रसा हुआ सात पीढ़ियों से, ऐसे इसको गा के भी सुना दो ना, सात पीढ़ियों से गाना रसा है खून में।
वो क्या है कि इसकी जो व्हाट यू कॉल इट पिच जो है, वायलिन की जो पिच है,
आई नो दैट्स लिटिल हायर, या इट्स नॉट द, इट्स डिफरेंट। तो अक्षर तो सुना दो पढ़ के, मैंने कहा पंजाबी तो सुनाओ थोड़ी सी।
सुनाती हूँ, वन मिनट।
पंजाबी तेरे मुंह सुनिए।
मुझको पूरा
मुंबई, मुंबई में पंजाबी भी तो सीख ली होगी ना?
नहीं।
अच्छा,
गलत भी हो सकता है, मैं अभी बता देती
हूँ।
मियाँ वे जाने वाले तेनु अल्लाह
देख ला, तेरे तेरे को पंजाबी भी सुन ली असि।
पता नहीं गलती ना हो तो माफ।
ना ना ना, ठीक है, भाषा के साथ, खास करके जो मातृभाषा नहीं है ना उसके साथ खिलवाड़ किया जा सकता है। जैसे मैं जब अंग्रेजी बोलता हूँ बड़ा अनअपोलोजेटिक बोलता हूँ, और मेरे एक बड़े थे वो कहते थे कि बड़े भाई
ऐसे ही मैं गा रही हूँ जो जो मैंने सुन के उसके बाद उनसे शब्द लेके जो मैं बुक मेंटेन करती हूँ ताकि मैं उसको ठीक
रहे। वेरी नाइस, या Yeah, Shaurya Mia was from Kapurthala, na, from Fagwada, where I come from. Actually, that's somehow our ilaka, in that sense. That's fantastic. So this was on the stage, the first Kolhapur stage.
When he sang this and showed, तब कि मुझे मतलब उनको ये याद था कि मैं कितनी जल्दी ये सब पिकअप करती हूँ. वो मुझे कंप्यूटर बुलाते थे, बिकॉज एक बार अगर वो गाते थे it would remain in my mind.
I see.
And I would tell him, नहीं नहीं लास्ट टाइम आपने ऐसा किया था तो so he would call me computer. अच्छा जब भूल जाते थे मुझे बुलाते थे और पूछते थे कि मैं कैसे गाता था बताओ.
But he would also be sometimes pretending, no, to check how much you remember.
तो मैं उनको हमेशा बोलती थी मैं अगर कंप्यूटर हूँ तो आप सुपर कंप्यूटर है.
That's fantastic. Yes. And how about his brother, the big brother, the extraordinary teacher, the udar dil, who shared so much? Did you have a chance to meet him?
No.
I see.
He had passed away by then.
Acha, acha, acha.
When I went to Pandiji, he had passed away.
I was looking at, you know, I was intrigued. In fact, today I was Diwan, you know, from Gandhar Mahavidyalaya, Madhup's, you know, he's been posting some of the stuff on YouTube, and I chanced Lalit Raoji's Shuddh Malhar today. And I was shocked because my family, you know, my ancestor was direct disciple of Guru Nanak. Bhai Sadharan, and we have music from the Bhagats, Bhagat Kabir, Ramanand, Baba Sheikh Farid, originals, and of course the Gurus. And we are the only ones in North now. Sometimes my conversation with Dr. Ritvik Sanyal and others, they in the mention you find in the books, the Sare Mapadhasa, Sadha Pama, the Shuddh Malhar. Today I've heard the recording by Lalit Rao. And then I was in that video recording, which is on YouTube, of the two brothers, of course. I think it's a Doordarshan interview, like a lekdam, in which Nat Narayan is being sung. What are the ragas? Again, we sing in Gurbani. And I was very amazed. And then there's a mention of the Rag Mala, that they're singing Rag Mala ragas. And your Guruji Pandit Jasraj is also pitching in. Then other disciples of his brother are also singing one composition or the other, or different ragas. So I was quite amazed at, you know, the idea of as a parampara bearer, as a head of a parampara. I have again coursed to diaries of all my elders and so on and so forth. It's amazing to see sometimes the kind of scholarship that existed, that music was not just like that. The Nat Narayan is so rare now. The way we've like dhurpads, old dhurpads, ek pade, do pade, chau pade, panch pade, ishpartals.
Is it the same way like what Panditji sings? Is the Nat Narayan the same?
In that recording is similar. The one, I don't know afterwards how he sings.
Let me play and ask you if it is this
sure,
one.
Sure, sure.
Thank you.
थोड़ा फर्क है, बट अगेन पुराने रागों के कई अंग होते थे. इट्स नॉट सरप्राइजिंग. वी एक धनासरी ले लें, मल्हार ले लें, कितने प्रकार हैं. शुद्ध के ही कई प्रकार हैं. तो इसमें आई सी दैट देयर इज अ कोमल निखाद शो आल्सो इन दैट एंड इन द नटराज द वे वी हैव. मैं मेरा गला गुला बैठा है. बेली स्लेप बट जस्ट टू गिव एन आइडिया. इट्स कंपोजिशन लेट आई थिंक 1670s कंपोजिशन बाय गुरु रामदास द फोर्थ गुरु. So dhavat nyas is very important. This is the chalan, na? The composition goes mere man सेव सफल हर घाल जी मेरे मन. सो द वन दैट यू डू आधनी सा दैट अंग कम्स हियर. आ मेरे मन सेव सफल हर घाल जी मेरे मन से सफल हर घाल ले गुर पगरे न रवाल ले गुर पगरे न रवाल सब दाले द भंज दुख दाल हरि हो नदर निहाल जी मेरे मन सेव सफल हर घाल. दिस इज जस्ट द अस्थाई ऑफ दैट एंड देन the stanzas go, it's a partal in which the rhythmic structure is the first of its kind. Har gagra har aap sware o har rang rang mel beyant lal lal hari lal hari apni kripa kari aap gray aayo hum har ki gur ki ab siti hum har dekhe bhai nihal 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 nihal. Then there is a chautal of Guru Arjan Dev. I think it will give you a very even clearer structure. Ola no mai kahu na diyo mare meet to ha. My throat is all dead. I'm very, very underslept, just to give an idea. But the one that the two brothers are singing is very similar. What you recording may have, I was like amazed. I said, wow, this is paramparas that have for decades maybe have had no interaction. But the new age scholars say, are raago ke mat bhed bade hain. I said, yaar, paramparao ko aap tatolo, there's not really much of a difference. Yeah, you see similarity. Even I was like shocked looking at Lalit Rao ji's Shuddha Malhar today, and I was very interested to learn about your interactions vis-a-vis rag forms. But I know that I'm sure we'll have that chance next time when we meet. I would love to delve into the rag forms, into the memory, old compositional structures. And so on and so forth. And I know that you have to leave soon. In a few minutes, we will wind off. You need to leave around 10:15 or so, no? What's the time now with you? 5-7 minutes or?
It's 10:08.
10:08, yeah, so about 6-7 minutes. Why don't we, I shouldn't have been singing. As I said, my voice is all dead right now. And you know, this is one instrument, as you were telling the bow, I was tightening it to show it to you. This is one instrument, the voice, we cannot pack it. So if I haven't slept, it shows, it'll show my voice, etc. Although it's not too bad, but just to give you an idea that it'll be great if you can share with us a composition from, to sum up today's conversation. We reminisce about your grandfather today. That's where we began, and I wanted to remember him. So if you can share to end with a composition that he would have shared with you, taught you when you were under 12, whether it was 9, 10, 4, 5, 6, if you can recall something from that time, that will be a fantastic way to offer salutations at his feet.
Okay, let's see.
So Nanda is saying hello.
Oh, say hello to her.
I'm not going to tell her your hello. Why would I tell her your hello? Sunanda, I hope you're listening. I'm not passing on Kala's hello to you.
So, my grandfather taught me Chayanat.
I see.
So, I will play.
Fantastic. I think that would be wonderful. Because I think your image is frozen. Your image got frozen. Let me call her back. Here you are, yes. I love this message from Hemlata Murali. She says, my granddaughter has a violinist doll named her as Kalaramnath. That's so sweet. That's so sweet. And of course, Sunanda was saying hello back, and I'm with great pain I'm passing that hello back to you. So
who was that?
Sunanda Sharma.
Okay.
And Shuchita Rao, of course, enjoying the Janana Janana Khayal and Rag Chayanat, and many others. Zainab Jawad from Lahore, from the Harsakian group, saying hellos. And Dalbir Singh Paisab from California saying namaskar to you. And many people, of course. And Poonam Ayub says, with mastery over the tappa singing, her guru Pandit Jasraj must have been truly proud of her varied accomplishments. Tanvir Sapra, of course, who studies with Neela Bhagwatji, has also said, I think, a million vahs to you. And of course, as I said, my regards to everyone, those who have joined. And I'm sure we'll get to converse with Kala Ramnath to continue. This is like the teaser, the beginning of our conversation. And thank you so much, Kala, that you joined and accepted my humble request.
No problem. Maybe there's a lot more to talk with you, you know, picking my brains. I think there'll be a lot more coming in the next session.
Yes.
Yeah.
I look forward to that, in fact. I think there's a lot in that, in the sense of ornamentation, the difference between the Carnatic, if there is a difference. Of course, in the Gurbani tradition, we have had the Rabab, the Dhurpadi Rabab, which I have handcrafted back to life as well. The Taus, yeah. You know, the Mayuri Veena, which I also had. That was the first bow instrument that I handcrafted back to life, recovered the playing techniques. And again, the bowing is very similar, and of course all follows singing. The length of the breath, the sooth, is very similar to what you're talking. It's age-old tradition of the idea of when the bow came over the pluck was to emulate the sooth. For example, if I have a composition with thiya, one word is stretched over 12 beats without a breath, how would the instrument, the rabab, cannot do it, because it's plucked and it's going to die. So the bow was brought in. My talk on instruments within the sacred, the bhakti and the margi and the deshi, it's about 13, 14 hours long, in which I talk about the plucked instrument, how the plucked instruments that are short in fret length, the ones that are long, what are they trying to gain, how they are trying to sort of have the sooth as a kitna lamba sooth hai. Jitna lamba sooth hoga, meen niklegi, usse andolit hoga. Kampit, Andol, etc., etc. Sambhavna. Bo does that. That's why all bo instruments are more closer to the human voice as such, and they're able to emulate much more that a human being, human voice can do. And of course, for the next segment, it'll be wonderful to have your insights about how you've seen the usage of violin in Carnatic Sangeet and the usage of violin in Northern Indian music, how the pure Tantrakari instrument playing, the difference with those guts compositions to versus the singing, how Veena and others age old was all following the singing. They were all Drupadiyas who were playing the Veena or the Rudrabeen, originally the Rabab. Now, of course, the other Veena is now called Rudrabeen, originally was the Drupadi Rabab. It'll be great to have your how you've seen over the years. And of course, rag forms and composition structure. But I love the tappa though. It's fantastic. Kya baat hai? Kya baat hai? Matlab wo jise kahein, there's another one. Lastly, Diwan has posted of Husn Lal ji singing. Who's a great violinist? Husn Lal ji singing a composition at the Gandharva Mahavidyalaya's old recording that he shared. I think it was from 1960. And imagine, I mean, there's a long tradition of great violinists also being very, very, quite fantastic singers. And I had heard rumors actually, I never heard you sing before. So, mujhe mere kano mein kahiyo ne bhara tha, kala ji gaati bahut achha hai, unse kahiye ka gaiye. So, I don't know how many people begged of me to egg you. I didn't have to, but of course our conversation, I said, don't worry, it usually happens in our conversations. But thank you, Kala. Go ahead.
I did not sing because when I play, the pitch is so high to sing, you know, without any warm up, just to go up like that. Yeah. First of all, it's not my pitch. My pitch is B flat.
Yeah, and this is like D. This is D.
D. Yeah.
I saw that. It's D, no? D as in delta, not E. D pe bajate ho. So, jab hum kabhi gaayenge ikatthe baithke, to mujhe tumhe dikkat na hogi mere sang bajane ki. So, I found that. I got that part.
Yes.
So, anything you would like to say to everybody before we call it a day for you?
Again.
Yes, we'll meet again. Yes. And I see that you're also doing some online sessions. You've been sharing during the COVID times. You're going live on your page, and that's I invite people to visit and subscribe and like her page, and do get to interact with her on her page as well. And you can ask her questions here for the next time. I'll keep a tag of anything that is asked this time. We'll keep it for the next time.
Okay.
All right, Kala. Thank you so very much again for joining today with us. Huh?
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
So friends, that was my conversation with Vidushi Kala Ramnath. I hope you enjoyed this conversation. It's just the beginning of a conversation, as we've already resolved to meet again in the next days. We'll try to match her itinerary of mine with hers. I'm the one who's requesting her for time in this case. The tables are turned, as you say. As a host, I have to request some of these stalwarts who've served so beautifully well in the fields of arts, culture, aesthetics, literature, films, and expression, if I may. And I'll see you on I'm meeting Friday. Let's see. I'm meeting with I'm going to be in conversation with Kamar Dagar, who's a pictorial calligrapher. Yeah, surprise. So this is going to be my first conversation with a calligrapher. This is Kamar Dagar. She's the doting daughter of Ustad Naseer Fayazuddin Khan, of the Dagur Vani, one of the four Vani of Turpat, of singing rather, and Khandar Vani, Nauhari Vani, Gaurhari Vani, and Dagur Vani. So she is the sister of Ustad Fayaz Wasifuddin Dagar, niece of Ustad Nasir Zahiruddin Khan, Ustad Nasir Aminuddin Khan, Ustad Nasir Moinuddin Khan of the Dagur Vani. And this will be, kindly take note of the time. It will be 5 p.m. Friday, September 25th, 2020. And dosto, 25 September Friday nu khushkati karde ne, pictorial khushkati, Kamar Dagar, ona de naal meri mulaqat hoegi 5 baje. Tusi tuhanu saryan de charnaach benti hai ke time note kar lena, te mainu aas hai ke aapan shukrawar mulaqat karange 5 baje. So until then, my salutations to you all. Thank you so very much for joining. Who all have joined? Narendra Pal Singh, Rashid Khan, Dayaram Sarolia, Gurinder Pal Mahi. I hope, Gurinder, you're better. I know that you've not been well. Rajendra Singh, and they're all sending. Tarinder Kaur has joined. Rani Radhakrishnan, Prasad, Thevarkat, Kiran Sood, Sangeet Gunjan Ahuja, Prasad, of course, I've taken your name. Shailendra Kumar Pathak, the Thrupad singer. It's wonderful to see you again. Gurjeet Kalo, Harminder Singh Kant, Satpal Ji, that's wonderful. Deji Ahuja, Ali Abdullah, Mandeep Bindra, Amarjeet Singh, Poonam, of course, Harinder Kaur, Gaurav Ruhela. That's very kind of you all. Gayatri Date, who's quite a poet now. She's been enjoying her poetry written in Marathi, I think. I get to understand sometimes. And Satkartar, back to you. Indu Arora. And of course, Sandeep Bhatt. And then we have... Poonam Ayub says, what great fortune, inspiration from the gods of music is truly what it was. And... Teji Huja says, Pandit Jasraj will be missed, his music is immortal. Well, one is true now, immortal in the sense that now, because all those, you know, the 20th century folks who got recorded are going to be sort of immortal. As long as technology remains, the recordings will be there to play immortal in the sense that as long as the world, humanity lives, we are not immortals actually. But... figure of speech, of course, I'm just teasing you back. Sandeep Bhatt says, you're an institution for all the music lovers. There is gain in knowledge whenever you say or play. Charan Sparsh, that's wonderful. I'm sure Kala Ramnath would appreciate that very much. Hamid Sahi is there, Himla Thamurali. I love that note about the daughter's doll. Pallavi Chatur, of course, Pallavi Chaturvedi, Namaskar Kala, and a big hi to Pallavi Bhai. Thank you very much, Pallavi. Look at that, Tanveer, you hungry felon. Could you play that now, please? I wanted Kala to play the tappa, I'm sure. Well, who didn't want? You were just one of the many, mister. And Narendra Pal, of course, Baljeet Singh and Suchit Kulkarni. Then we have Sejal Joshipura, who says she's an amazing singer, and we all saw that today, isn't it? Sharanjit Singh Ragi from South Africa. I'm so glad that you could join. And then Pagamol Singh Gill, Sat Sri Akal, back to you, Gill Sahab. Amarjit Singh says, what a subtle art of storytelling. And Suranda, missing you here. I wish you could have joined in, but Kala had to go. She had an appointment with her. She's got some back issue, has to have it checked. And then Mr. Chita Rao, of course, who says such ease in bringing out the essence of a raga on the violin. Indeed, indeed. Aditya Deep, very nice conversation, says Sunanda is trying to praise me with a very, very sort of barren, non-fragrant, kya baat, Baldeep ji. I wonder if it's a question from you, kya baat hai, oye, kind of a thing, or a wah wah, kya baat hai. You haven't specified, there's no exclamation point. Well, your exclamation point would have been suspect. Dalbir Singh, of course, Bhai Sahib is here, hello back, and I hope, Zainab, you enjoyed this conversation. It was brief, but as a beginning of a conversation. Rintu Bhatia, kya baat, Baldeep ji, you're doing a great job in this crucial time, thank you very much. Nitin Handa says pranam back to you from both me and Kala. Shilpi Ravi, wonderful, she says, who claims to be watching from Kolkata. Wonderful. I mean, how would we know you're watching from Kolkata? Claims, you know, you could be sitting on the moon and talking to us. How would we know? Sejal Joshipura says, excellent session, thank you very much. I wonder, I'm responsible for that, or Kala Ramnath is. And then we have, oh, Kalapani Kokali, hello. And bahut achhi baatcheet ho rahi hai. See, Kalapani, tumne jaise hi kaha ki baatcheet ho rahi hai, wo uske jaane ka time ho gaya. But she beat your record of going back early. But she's coming back again. And Ramanjit is here too. We look forward to seeing you at our session tomorrow by Baldeep Singh ji. Yes, in fact, there is a... Let me see if I can share that. How can I share that? Let's see if I can share it straight from... there is a Baithak tomorrow, which is being hosted by the Creative Arts. And let's see if I can open that. There's a wonderful session tomorrow, which the Creative Arts Academy of here they are, I think must be here. Let's see. Not this one. Let me now share the screen for you all. Let us see. If it works, show Safari only. So this is the page of the Creative Arts Academy, and this is the session from yesterday. Oh, this is the one, yes, here we are. Let's see if I can click onto that. Can we open it? Yes, we can. Okay. And how do I do here? I can. I see. To exit full screen. Let me do like this. Oh yeah! Look at that. I'm getting better at this software. So this is the conversation tomorrow, which is hosted by the Creative Arts Academy. Let me get out of here. And this is, let me get out of here too. Tomorrow at 6 p.m. on the Creative Arts Academy page. This will be hosted by Swati Gautam, who's an entrepreneur, trustee, Calcutta Debating Circle, and there's a panel discussing Communicate Connect, it's called. The webinar series is called From Idea to Expression. Jessica Gomes is principal lawyer to Convent Antilly, and then Taranjeet Kaur is actor, poet, co-founder of Pad Squad. And then we have S. V. Raman, who's the director of communications at the Creative Arts Academy. And yours truly, the music maestro, virtuoso, conservator, etc., etc. So that's the program for tomorrow, and I hope to see you all tomorrow. And Professor Abhinav Savra is also here, one of the world's finest conservation architects. Chandima Roy says, she's really enjoyed the session. Kalaji is one of my favorite instrumentalists. I'm so glad to hear that. And so I was very happy to hear, as I mentioned, Lalit Raoji's Malhar. There's a Diwan Singh, DIWAN, has been posting recordings from Gandharv Mahavidyalaya, and I was also amazed at looking at some of the discussions that were done in 1955, 56, and 1960. I think some of the conversations I've been looking at about rag forms. My take is a little different. I saw that several people, including Pandit Dilip Chandra Bedi and another, I think Pandit S. N. Ratan Shankar also, almost like questioning the idea that, to the level of mocking even, there's a malhar, Shuddh Malhar, sung with a Tivra Madhyam. They were questioning, oh, how come, everybody's singing? But I think one of the unnamed grandmasters, I think Ustad Mushtaq Hussain Khan or someone, says that there were two kinds. One were the pandits, one were the gavayas. And he mentioned about his conversations with Pandit Vishnu Narayan Bhatkhande as well, that who would acknowledge that I'm just a pandit, you're the gavaya. So the usage of a rag, how a use is happening, and how a rag is evolved or a rag variant is formed, those are all important. I think the mistake that was done in the mid 20th century, when post-independence, was that people were just trying to be correct. That is where I think a lot of heritage was lost. I think those opportunities, I mean, the opportunity existed at that time to map all the information that there is, not to snub people. Well, how are you singing that malhar? How can that be the malhar? I hear, for example, Pandit Dilip Chandra Bedi mentioning that how can there be a raga without seven notes? In one of the that all of them should have all notes, should sampurna notes. But then, if I were to tally it with the words of when I did research and went up to Lahore to meet with the sons of Ustad Mohre Mausiki, the title given by Zaid-e Bukhari, the director, I mean, one of the heads of All India Radio, and then later on who headed Radio Pakistan, he gave the title before partition to Ustad Mir Ali Khan, the Talwandi School, the Khandarwani singer, Mohre Mausiki, the seal of music. His sons, Mohammad Afzal Khan and Mohammad Hafiz Khan, I interacted with, and they would talk about that every rag is sampuran, because the moment you do a mean, for example, you look at Malshri, so by way of the mean and the sudh, all shrutis within the octave are touched, but there are gupt and pragat. Some notes are pragat. So when you look at the grammar in totality, then you can understand the archaic, gathic, samas, samarantar, jati ragas, the one note, two note, three note, and four note ragas. And then Arav Ghatav Sampuran is somehow the new age musicology of South Asia, has somehow say, oh no, rag must have five notes and six and seven notes. It doesn't work like that. The scholars centuries ago were not nuts, they were not bonkers, they were not inebriated in some sort of ignorance that they were writing all of that. They were very learned people. And the idea is basically there's only one note. So how you've done the khand within that is different. So, that's one thing which is shared by all the ragas. So that's So how are you dividing that single octave is the point, but the actual sa to sa is the same. So you understand the idea of what is an archaic roop raga. Then you have the gathic roop, and don't you sing, you say, oh, the Rajasvi Rikham of Shri, the moment you awaken it, the rag is awakened. You're singing single note raga every time you do, and you're fooled by your knowledge. then how can there be a raga? You say, oh, ji, Mia Malhar, the Andolit Gandhar or Darbari Khan Andolit, that's the way the raga is formed. Then that means the raga is already happening in a single note. What is the idea of Vadi and Samvadi? The moment you have a Samvadi, you already have a Gathic Swarup Raga, two note raga. You say, re, re, pa, pa, re, re, hai, re, 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 pa, re, re, pa. Shri raga is already existing. What is the problem in it? Samajati, three note raga. Swami Haridas is a nut, right? He's bonkers, he's illiterate. If he's singing, is he bonkers? Etc. Pandit Sajan Mishra sang a Malshri of Sadarang. Right? People were not bonkers. They were very learned people. Then you have the Samajati, then you have the Savarantar Jati, four note ragas, and so on and so forth. I think the idea, listening to all those recordings from the 50s and other conversations that I've been privy to and debated with people who were born in the first decade, second decade of the 20th century, they became correctional officers. That was not the point at the time. You needed to have an anthropological bent to recover and record on paper by way of audiovisual documentation as much as music as possible. Ustad Chand Khan is mentioning about, I counted 48 Malhars that he remembered. Why not document all of them? Why to start judging? Oh, how can you sing 48? How can this rag form be there? How is that? Where is the rag Malhar? First document it. Do not outrightly reject something or accept something. That's not how responsible attendance to culture works. And I'm sure Professor Rabindra Basavada, who's one of the world's finest conservators, we're so proud of his work, that he has, the way he has contributed, the dialogue that he has participated in, the discourse he is engaged in on the fields of tangible heritage conservation. And I've, of course, got long-standing conversations with some of the elders from the architect, some of the top conservation architects as well, about what the idea of conservation is. People like Randy Hester, who specialized in, and his wife Marcia McNally, formerly from UC Berkeley, who did landscape architecture. He spoke of sacred landscaping, meant that the idea of vernacular, that if he's identifying the habitat for a rare or near extinct bird or an extinct bird, which is almost extinct, they are looking at the natural habitat, not creating a Japanese garden somewhere in California. That you can do for your fancy ideas, but when you talk of nature, you have to allow the soil to grow what it has grown for millions of years. That's how sacred landscaping works. So a similar attendance has been, sort of employed or deployed within the field of South Asian culture and its traditions. But in the 20th century, I think everybody was thinking himself or herself is more smart, more intelligent than the other, that an opportunity to document, to map the memory of the stalwarts who still were with us, or still available to audiovisual technology, when the midnight clock, the clock struck midnight 1947, August 15th, things could have been done. It's a pity so little exists. Tokenism only exists. One token here, one token there. Ragmala, as I mentioned, was interested in conversing with Kalaramnath. All the examples, my question is that how is it that all the Ragmala versions are Chota Khayal compositions? Where are the Ragmala compositions? Like, for example, the Ragmala in Guru Granth Sahib is stamped in 1604 AD by the fifth Guru. There was no Khayal as Chota Khayal is sung today. So those Ragmala ragas would have certainly been sung in the Dhurpad format or the Chant format. Where are those compositions? And you cannot blame me for not remembering them or not recording them, because not much has reached me. How is it that all the traditions were singing only Chota Khayal? What was so great about this Mundi Dhurpad, as Professor and Dr. Vidyadhar Vyas was mentioning about how the Gwalior, the Sadarang Adarang compositions are called Mundi Dhurpad, that means you took the head of the Dhurpad, the Asthayi and the Antara, you're creating small compositions. What about the Sanchari and Abhog? What is the loss that a rag incurs or a composition incurs the moment you subtract a Sanchari and Abhog from it? Don't you need the third line? Why did the third line come into existence? It's almost like having a road in the having a house in the jungle, but with no roads, no passageway. You're totally cut off. There's no way to come. There's no communication. It's like a human body bereft of, I mean, denied oxygen. These, I think, are very painful, reflections on how the memory of Vidwans and Vidyadhars in the 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s was dealt with. They were not mapped. They were being screened. Okay, only if you sing the rag this way, we will accept. You sing otherwise, we don't want that information. That is not how it works. Rag Deepak, I mean, the way I remember is in Kafi Mail, for example. I sing Deepki with a different mela, with a Tivra Madhyam mela. You look at Pandit Vidur Malik. He's singing a Deepak in a certain mala. I had a discussion with his very, very talented son, Pandit Dr. Prem Kumar Malik. And then you have another Deepak sung by another maestro. I mean, Pandit Ramchandra Malik is singing. It's a little different. All are important. Dhanasri are mishrit, two pure Dhanasri in Kafi Mela. There's 6-7 verses of Dhanasri that I still remember. We need to be hungrier than we are. We need to say we need to hear all rag forms, all of them. And then we analyze them, document them. Our future generations will be richer by way of that. You cannot start judging, oh, that is right and that isn't right. It doesn't work like that, my friend. You know, Raja Amrinder Singh, of the uncle of the current Chief Minister of Punjab, Captain Amarinder Singh. I had a very bittersweet relationship with him. The very first time he tried to debate with me, he lost it. It was on the Rag Deepak and Rag Deepaki. Because he only knew Rag Deepak. My granduncles, Pai Avtar Gujjar, only knew Rag Deepaki. And I had learned both. So I told Raja Amrinder Singh, he challenged me, he said, oh, your granduncles know nothing about this and that. I said, what happened? He said, I asked them about if Deepak has to have Gandhar like Patdeep and all the combinations of Deepak has Komal Gandhar and so on and so forth. How is it that they are, what they are singing? I said, well, I'm the grammarian in the family. Why don't you ask the same question to me? Yeah, he said, he was like, it was the first lunch meeting. And then he says, oh, how come you're singing Deepak like that? I said, Raja Sahab, you're correct. And Pai Avtar Singh, Gurcharan Singh are also correct. And he scoffed at me, laughed at me. He said, ah, you're trying to be good to both of us. I said, no, because you're right, because you only know one form. They're right because they know the other form. I've learned both. He said, what do you mean? And I started singing a Dhrupad of Rag Deepak. Deepak Kathana Mail, etc., etc. The moment I sang this, I said, oh, really? You remember this? I said, I told you. I know, and they are singing this and this and that. So, why this kind of battle? When you have so many rag variants, it simply meant you need to understand, you need to learn how to interpret this. It simply meant a rag was so big that it had multiple variants. Multiple variants. It was a sign of a big raga. It is not a sign of a small raga. And to understand one rag, you need to collect all rag versions, you know, of that particular, you know, melodic mode in question or in conversation, in sort of in question where you're focusing on, or in focus, if I may rephrase. And then you talk later, then you analyze later. But first preserve the intangible wealth or the memory that has come and that has been saved for centuries and centuries, whatever has been, been able to reach us. These are problems anyway. I thought I'll share with you the issues and the problems that I, as a conservator, have been grappling with the egos, you know, oh God, you know, ego, how much damage it has inflicted on the South Asian cultural heritage. Oh, my teacher is the greatest singer. Oh, my father, my mother, my uncle, my aunt, my great-grandfather, my great-granduncle, my this, my ustad, this whole, my, we are the best. This is a disease. We must understand, we are all students of the Raghunath system. And so where does, we need to be grateful that we learn, we have been able to learn some. That is the etiquette with which we need to attend. We cannot pretend to be gods, because there are people who are more informed than you, more informed than me. And this hanker dies a quick death. It's only people isolate themselves in small wells and they walk like gods and goddesses. But South Asian culture is bigger than an individual family tradition. It's bigger than one system of singing or playing. It is so big that it has birthed so many gharanas, so many schools, so many systems, and yet it is not done. There's capacity for more and more and more. Anyway, I take your leave. It is 11:19 and I'm signing off. I wish you a wonderful, wonderful night if you're in South Asia, and a very good day to you if you're, you know, sort of, if you're doing Avaragardi in the Pacific Standard Time Zone. Have a wonderful day to you, you all out there. I'll see you on Friday at 5 p.m. September 25th, I think. Chandrima Roy says, in instrumental compositions of Shahjahanpur, Gharana of Sarod, we play Sanchari and Abhog. Dudgats also have a sthai in Mancha. And an antra of at least 3 avartanas. Yes, but they're all, anywhere where there's a Sanchari, Abhog, those are flat out compositions, the Dhrupad compositions, which have been adapted into khayal. And Sarod, when you play, it has a direct link with the Dhurpadi Rabab, where from the original compositions come from there. And I would love to have a conversation with you on that, Chandrima Roy. Thank you for sharing that, and hope to have a look at it one of these days. And we'll connect via messenger or something beforehand. Thank you all, and I look forward to see you tomorrow, by the way, with, if you have time at 6 p.m. I think was the time tomorrow at the Creative Arts Academy page, and on Friday with Kamar Nagar as part of our ongoing Yarnath Virtual Barrack series. It'll be Mela number 137. Until then, Khuda Hafiz. Varjik ka khalsa, Varjik fateh, namaskar, a very good night and a good day. As I mentioned, if you are in the time zone where the sun still dances up in the skies, Sat Kartar.